Good evening. So just to some disclaimer, I'm really a beginner in doing this machine learning. So I will just share what I have learned from the web, and I think along the way, actually, I have a lot of questions. And if any of you have any pointers you can give during the talk or after the talk, you know, feel free to come and tell me lah. Okay. So I think this is really this started as a pair data, which started by Eugene. Yeah, but I think I got a partner, but he eventually couldn't come because he was too busy. But he actually pointed me to this competition. So I thank him for that lah. Okay. So without further ado, I'll just go straight into the problem itself. Okay. So the problem is actually quite straightforward. Okay. We have a few features that's given to us. For example, the resource. Okay. These are, I suppose, they are probably IT resource programs and applications. Okay. And then you have the manager ID. What are the roles? What are the family, role family description, etc. So based on these features, you're supposed to predict, okay, whether this resource will be approved to this employee or not. Okay, so that's quite straightforward. Okay, so what is the scoring method? Okay, scoring method is using the ROC curve. Okay, so you need to do a predict the probability lah, okay? Okay. Okay, we'll go. So first of all, what we do is we look at the data and I did a describe on it, okay, just to see what is the distribution of the data. So from here, okay, this is the test set and this is the train set. First of all, we can quickly notice, okay, that this data is pretty skewed, okay. You can see in terms of the frequency, the top frequency this is the ID detection here, okay. You can see over here that there's two value, one or zero, okay? And the frequency of approved resource is actually 30,872, okay, out of 32,000. Okay, so this is mainly all approved resources. A few other observations that we can see, okay, is that there are some information, okay, that is in the training set, some information that is in the test set. Okay, that's not in the training set. For example, the manager ID, that's 4971 unique, but in the train set, there's only 4,243. Okay, so these are just some observations that's made along the way. We also do notice that the run code and the row code and the row title has the same number of unique values. Okay, so we'll see the implication of that as we go later down. So the row title.
These are the counts, right?
So yeah, these are the counts.
You have 177 unique values for roll up 2.
Sorry.
So you have for roll up 2, you have 177
unique values. Yes, correct. So yeah, so you can see that there's 243 unique row titles and 243 unique row codes. Okay, so there may be some relationship there. Okay. Okay, so moving on, okay, I did a pair plot. Okay, this is pretty small. Okay, but I was looking at the categorical data. They are basically all categorical data. So actually, I don't think this can make much sense. Okay, so I realized after looking, but for some reasons, this row code and row title, it shows some form of a straight line there. So maybe we can see something for that, but it's not really very useful. Okay, so over here, what I did was actually we do a pivot. Okay, so we can actually match the number of unique values, okay, from the family description, okay, to each of the different columns. So this is basically it. And from here, we can actually see that row code to row title is a one-to-one relationship. Okay, so row code to row title. Okay, row title here is 1, and row title to row code is also a 1 here. Okay, so we could infer that they are basically the same. Okay, and then from here we could just say we can just drop one of them in the machine learning itself. Okay, and some other things of interest is row family to row code is 1 to m, 1 to many. Row family to row title is also 1 to many.
What's this table?
Okay.
Correlation.
It's not basically I'm doing the unique counts, okay, for each manager ID, then I find the maximum number of unique. So let me recall this a bit. So basically, I'm saying that for this one, okay, I did a pivot, right? So I pivot it, okay, then I count, let's say, okay, I take the actions, the manager ID, okay, this is the pivot for each of this. So I did some while back ago, okay, but when I pivot row code against all the different columns, I get the unique numbers of it, okay? So for this manager ID to this row code, I think it's a bit hard for me to explain. Maybe I can come back to you on that later.
Okay. I think what you're doing is you are looking at the, for example, row code and manager ID, what is the maximum number of unique manager IDs assigned to one particular row code. So
yes,
that's
correct.
How you get one-to-one.
Correct. So when we have one-to-one for this row title to row code, it's basically there's the max is one for the mapping. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So that's why we can infer that it's a one-to-one relationship. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So the next step that most of them did on the forum is that they create a lot more features. Okay. Based on the original set, they actually pair up the data. I guess this is to surface more complex relationships. Okay, so for example, to put it into more concretely, what they do was they do a tuples and a triples. So for example, they will put the manager ID and resource together as one new feature, and manager and row code together as one feature. Okay, so they do that for tuples and triples of it. Okay. So in order to have a, how do we generate the new value when we do a tuple and a triple? Okay, we need to, there needs to be a function to actually hash that number into a unique value. So I use the Cantor pairing, which is also from the forum. They say that this one doesn't have, it's quite safe that it won't have duplicates. There won't be, So I use that, and then I came up with a new feature set. Okay. So now the problem with the feature set is that it's extremely huge. Okay, if you look at the number of unique values, okay, you'll see that you also can look at the actual code itself. Okay, the resource IDs are actually very long. Okay, so when you pair this all together, Scikit cannot take in categorical data, right? You have to actually convert it to the one-hop vector. Okay, so when you do that, it becomes a sparse array. Okay, and when you become a sparse array, you are limited by the number of the algorithms that you can use are actually very limited already, because not all the algorithms in Scikit can actually support sparse array, okay, from my understanding. Okay. Okay. So I will touch on that, how I deal with that later. Okay. So once we have so many features, okay, we need to actually do a selection of what the features to use. So on the forum, they use greedy algorithm, okay, and some of them say they took 6 hours to actually get a good set, and I didn't have that time. I didn't want to run my algorithm for so long. So I did another thing. I tried using a decision tree, because decision tree can give you what are the important features. Okay, and I did this, and I did a comparison of my results with their results, and my result lost. Okay, it's not as good, definitely not as good, because I suppose the greedy algorithm is maybe more efficient at getting the features.
You lost by how much?
I'll show you later. Oh, okay. Yeah. But I mean, even 0.01 in Kaggle is like a lot, right?
Yeah, Kaggle a lot.
Okay, so over here what I have is actually I have, these are the, people are very generous, they actually put up what good feature set they have generated from their greedy algorithm. So this is one of the set, this one of their set, and my one, the ET features, is another set by itself. Okay. So these are the columns that are actually being chosen.
So did you run the greeting algorithm?
I didn't run. Okay. Yeah. So I cheated actually. Okay. So this was what I was talking. There's really a huge number of features, right? Okay, so I use a few methods. Okay, I use the naive Bayesian. This one is okay. This one can run the full feature set. It accepts the sparse array. Okay, but as I've tried running over here, the results weren't too good. Okay, it only gave me a 86%. Okay, I did a randomized search CV to get the best for this parameter at alpha to calculate what's the alpha. So it gave me a 0.18, and then on the result, on the Kaggle is 0.866. Okay, so this one, it's basically I'm treating like a black box. I just throw in the parameters and then it gives me the results. Yeah. So the other one that I tried was the logistic regression. So this one was actually, it's a very simple one, but then yet it can give you very high results. Okay. So this one, I just run. I do a CV loop here. Okay, just to check how is the prediction on the loop on the training set, and then basically it did much better, 0.89 on the Kaggle, and then for my decision tree, it gave a 0.88. So it's pretty much a huge difference. Yeah, and apparently this logistic regression can also help to, using the class weight balance, it can help to minimize the effect of the skewed data. Yeah, so that's what I read. So that's for the logistic regression. Okay, so next come to the random forest. So random forest will have the problem now that it can't accept the sparse array. Okay, so how I read how other people did it was pretty interesting. I couldn't really understand it. Okay, I only have an intuition right now after looking at it many times. Okay, basically they do a count data analysis. Okay, they count what is the number of features, the number of. So for example, maybe just show this table, it's much more simple to understand. So they do a count. This is the count data. This one is the count data. So for each ID that you have, you just count the number, how many rows of 67 there are. Okay, and then they'll just pump in the data over here, 71. Okay, so you can see all the 67 will just be placed with 71. Okay. They also have another one which is by percentage. So this is using resource. So they group by manager ID and then by resource. So you can see for 67 and 67 and 26. Okay, so this both actually gave the same percentage over here. Okay, so the only intuition I think I can get from this is when you do this count, you're putting in some ordering, okay? As in, if you have a lot of those resources, this will be a very large number. So at least instead of a random ID, now it becomes maybe an order of magnitude, okay? You know which has a higher percentage, yeah? Somehow this information is able to help you to do the machine learning. Yeah, so I can be wrong, but this is what I can understand so far from it. Yeah, if anybody can explain that to me, I'll be happy to listen. Yeah. Okay. So once you do this, okay, the number of rows is drastically reduced because now you don't need to use a one-hot vector. These are continuous values. You can just throw into the random forest itself. Okay. So with this random forest, I did ensemble learning. Basically, it's like the wisdom of the crowd, right? You have four learning algorithms, and then you see which one has the highest, vote, and then you give it to it. Then you say that, let's say three say this one, the other one say it's zero, then you go with this three, something like that. Okay. So I run through this four. Okay, this is also from the winning solution. I got their, they use the random forest, the extra tree classifier, and the gradient boosting with the logistic regression. Okay, so I just change it a little bit. Okay, I use a SciPy to do optimization. Okay, so that to optimize, I run for three training data sets. I get a prediction. Okay, then I run through all this prediction against the optimization program to see what is the weights that I should give to each of these trees. Okay, so the code is basically over here. I do a loss function, and I use the matrix of the AUCC score. Okay, and then I've got the weights. Okay, so these are the weights for each of the algorithm. So apparently, logistic regression got the highest score. So I mean highest weight lah. So it's still much very dependent on the logistic regression. Okay, and then it improved by much a lot. Okay, it jumped to 0.91. So it's quite good. Okay. Okay. So the last thing that I tried was to do the ensemble learning. Okay, with a logistic function. So just now was I use four together. Now, I take the results of these four, and then I pump it through another logistic regression. Okay. So this one is slightly a bit more complicated. I'm not sure whether I did it correctly, but what I did was I have to do two training loops. So first I split the train and test set, right? So the train set, I will run the four algorithms. Okay. Then the result from that, okay, on the test set, I will split it up again to another train and test set. Okay, so the train set, I will run the logistic regression from this. Okay. And then the test set I use to cross-validate to see whether am I overfitting or not. Okay. So that's roughly how I did it. Okay. Over here, before I used the logistic regression, the forum suggested that you apply inverse logistic function, because the first train set actually comes out, what it comes out is actually a prediction, it's a probability. Okay. So by doing the inverse logistic function, that's something I don't understand as well. Okay. But it seems to work. Okay. Yeah. I mean, I guess it makes sense, because if all your output is just 0.98 and 0.9, and you do a logistic function on it, I'm not sure. But yeah, it's like, so this one, if someone can explain to me, okay, I'll be here, happy to hear it also. So this one definitely gave me the best results. So this is my cross validations, and then finally, yes, give me a 0.91096, which is just a little bit higher than the previous one. Yeah. Okay. Okay. That's the end. It's just a short talk. Hope to just share the experience. And I think this was a very interesting experience for me, learning from the forum. And I do think the pair data is actually a very promising thing that, I mean, I'll be really interested to work with other people, you know, if anybody interested, to learn together. Because many times when you do this, you are really stuck, and certain things you can try to look on your own, but it's difficult. Yeah. So if anybody is willing to learn together, you know, can come to look for me, and then we can try on something. Okay, that's all.
Any questions for Zhenhao? Is the competition over?
Yeah, it's over already.
And what was the winning score?
The winning score, I can't remember. It's 0.99 something. Or so. It's much higher than mine. It's much higher than mine.
How big was the data set?
How big? I can show you here.
In terms of number of entries for both the test and the tree.
I think I have the numbers here. Over here lah, yeah. So about 30,000 and 50,000 lah. 30,000 for the actually I can see it from my this one. The count here. Yeah. Yeah. Oh, 500,000, sorry. And 300,000. No, 30,000, 30,000. And 50,000, sorry.
Yeah. The test set was larger than the...
Yeah, the test set is larger. Yeah.
Is that everything in your GitHub?
Sorry?
In your GitHub, you posted it.
Yeah, I posted it on my GitHub.
Also, the data set.
The data set you can download from Kaggle.
It's still there.
Okay. Yeah.
So, actually, which section of Kaggle is that competition under? Is it an educational or was
no,
it?
No, it's an actual competition. Yeah. So you can just search for Kaggle Amazon. You'll pop up in the first search. Yeah.
Roughly how long do you think to train from content?
On this one?
Yeah.
It's quite fast, lah. It's quite fast. I think the longest one that will take is really the greedy algorithm portion. Because basically you're running all the features and in an iterative way, lah. Yeah. So this data set is actually quite easy to work with. You don't have to like wait for hours for the results to come out. Yeah.
Do you need to do any data cleaning?
No, this is pretty clean. It's pretty clean. Yeah. So that's why it makes it much easier. Yeah.
What's the ramp on this?
Sorry?
Huh? How did it ramp in the competition?
Well, I cheated, right? I took all the other people's script, so yeah. But I was pretty high up, like, I think maybe close to the 100. But I took the winning competition's results and made only some minor amendments to it. Yeah.
So for your first Kaggle experience, what part of this did you find most interesting?
I think to apply it, actually. Because before that, what got me interested was the Andrew Ng's Coursera. And it was quite a good experience going through that, because it suddenly made me realize I can actually at least get an intuition of how it works, although I may not understand it perfectly. But then going through the Kaggle makes me think about how I actually can apply that that knowledge. Yeah. So I think it really needs to hands-on to really understand. Yeah. Yep.
Any last question? We'll thank Zhenhao for sharing. That's